I thought we'd have a look at some of the shortest papers that have ever been written.
One of the sort of most famous ones was this one here by Lander and Parkin, which you can literally see, look how short it is. There's virtually nothing there, but the content's really good because it actually disproves a very long-standing conjecture that had held for hundreds of years.
So they were just disproving with an actual example.
Exactly. We're disproving the Euler conjecture. And what is the Euler conjecture? Well, it's kind of related to Fermat's last theorem. Fermat's theorem, what does it say? You've got two numbers, A1 to the K plus A2 to the k equals b to the k, and there basically it says there are no integer solutions for k greater than 2. Okay, that's Fermat's last theorem. What's Euler's conjecture, or it's a generalization of this, it basically, you just take n of these guys, and again, now you're saying Euler's conjecture would be there are no integer solutions for k greater than n. So no integer solutions for k greater than n, so of course Fermat's last theorem is the case of n equals 2. This is the general case, right? But this is not true, right? This paper proves it, right? Basically, in this example, n is 4, but k is 5. Disproven. There you go. So, in a nutshell, they disproved. But this doesn't have the record anymore. I don't know if it ever did have the record. It's sort of a classic short paper that achieves quite a lot. The record is, I think, currently held by this paper, by your friend John Conway, somebody called Alex Sofer, I think it is. I think that's how you pronounce it. Okay, so they ask a question in the title, so I think that's a bit of a cheat. And then, so they're basically asking about how many equilateral triangles you need to cover an equilateral triangle of a given size. So basically, the paper just says n squared plus 2 can, and then it has a picture of their solution. So it's kind of like got two words in it, right? They have the following question, right? So you take an equilateral triangle, and you imagine it's got a length of side n. And then you could ask, well, how many triangles of side 1, you know, so unit side triangles, equilateral triangles, do I need to fill it, to cover it? Well, you know the answer. It turns out to be n squared. It's quite easy to see that. Show you by example, if you've got side 2, so we've got side 2, you know, we can fill it with 4 equilateral triangles like that. So, and these have all got side 1, and they fill, 4 of them fill the equilateral triangle of side 2.
Which is 2 squared.
Which is 2 squared, exactly, right? And it generalizes, and the answer is n squared for 1 of side n. Okay, so what these guys wanted to know is, well, what if we make it a little bit bigger than n? You know, not n plus 1, but just a little bit bigger than n, so n plus epsilon. Right. How many do you need then? Okay, so you might think, I know I'm going to need more than n squared, because I've gone, n squared would cover the original one, right? But so I'm going to need more than that. So I'm going to need at least n squared plus 1. So they were asking, well, can you do it with n squared plus 1? And they didn't actually answer the question. They say, actually, you need n squared plus 2. How do they show that?
Well, what you do is you sort of stop it at n minus 1. So you draw, consider n minus 1 there. Okay, and then you've got a little bit there of 1 plus epsilon.
So you've got a little 1 plus epsilon bit there. Okay, now this thing, this bit in here, is going to need n minus 1 squared to fill it. Okay, now what they do is they say, right, what do I need to fill this little bit left over here?
Well, the way they do it is, you know, this has got length n plus epsilon that way. Okay, so you squeeze in, you're not going to cover these edges with n edges of the triangle, right? You're going to need at least n plus 1, okay? So you squeeze in n plus 1 of them, okay? Like so.
Maybe overlapping.
They definitely have to overlap, right? Because this is n plus epsilon, so it's n plus a tiny bit. Okay, and you're going to squeeze in n plus 1 of them, so they're definitely going to overlap. So you get n plus 1 of them there, okay? And you fill in the top bits, okay? And to fill in the top bits, so on and so forth, you need another n. Okay? And then you can do it. So how much have you got total now, in total? You've got n minus 1 squared plus n plus n plus 1. Okay? As you work out what that is, this is n squared minus 2n plus 1 plus 2n plus 1, which is n squared. Plus 2.
The extra bit, you know, it could be less than 2. They're just showing...
Yeah, so this is what I think about it. I don't think they even answer the question. The question is, can n squared plus 1 unit equilateral triangles cover an equilateral triangle of side n plus epsilon? They don't say yes or no. They just say n squared plus 2 can.
So maybe they could have just said maybe. I don't know, they don't answer the question. If you look in other fields, there are shorter ones though, right? I mean, I found some others. There's this one. It's not maths, but it's in the applied behavior analysis, it's the unsuccessful self-treatment of a case of writer's block. Of course, there's nothing there. There's another one, you know, comprehensive overview of chemical-free consumer products. This is in a chemistry journal, and there aren't any. Actually, this didn't appear in the journal. They didn't publish it, but they did include it for amusement purposes. There's plenty of short papers out there. There's also short abstracts. There's another thing you can look at. This is one that caught my attention. This is a physics one. Can the apparent superluminal neutrino speeds be explained as a quantum weak measurement? And there's a classic thing within academia that if your title has a question mark at the end of it, then the answer is probably not. And indeed, their abstract is probably not. I would actually say definitely not, because we now know that there are no faster than light neutrinos, that was just a screwed up experiment. There's an even shorter abstract there. There's another one with a question. Is the sequence of earthquakes in Southern California with aftershocks removed Poissonian? So this is a sort of mixture of maths and, I guess, geography. But the answer isn't probably not, it's yes. So that sort of goes against the usual rules of the game. But this is all, that's just a bit of fun, right? But I think what would be better is, like, it's not so much how short the paper is, but in a way, impact per word. Okay, so a short paper that achieved a lot. Okay, now this is clearly open to debate, but I think that the candidate for this is this bad boy by the beautiful man John Nash. So this is a very, very short paper. Literally, it starts there and it finishes there. Okay, so it's a page long. And this basically started off game theory. This is really, you know, one of the main papers underlying economics. He basically ultimately won the Nobel Prize for economics for this paper and you know, other ideas related to it. So I think in terms of impact per word, this is probably the winner. John Nash's thesis is famously short as well. I've got a copy of his thesis here. Non-cooperative, of course, it's about game theory, non-cooperative games. It's only like 26 pages long. Like, wow, you know what I mean? This thesis won a Nobel Prize and it's 26 pages long. There's a sort of a bit of an urban myth. If you do a maths degree, as I did, there's an urban myth that goes around the students as to, apparently there's this PhD thesis that someone did once and it's like a page long and it proved some result from that hadn't been known for hundreds of years and it just did it in one page and there you go, bang, PhD thesis came out. I think that is a myth, but I would love it if somebody found it out that it wasn't. I've had a little digging around and I don't think it is. I think in terms of short theses, big impact, you do well to be good old John Nash.
This episode has been supported by audible.com. And if you've got some reading to catch up on, an audiobook is a great way to do it. Among Audible's vast collection of titles is the acclaimed book A Beautiful Mind, the biography of John Nash, who we've just been discussing. It's written by Sylvia Nasser. Or if biographies aren't your thing, but you still want something with a bit of a math twist, I also highly recommend The Humans, a novel by Matt Haig and one of my favourite stories of the last few years. But whatever the sort of thing you like, I can guarantee Audible's going to have it. And you can also get started with a free 30-day trial by going to audible.com/numberphile. They've got a great store, a cool app, really excellent features like Whisper Sync for voice so you can synchronise your audiobook and Kindle without losing your place. And if you do give that free 30-day trial a go, make sure you use the address audible.com/numberphile just so they know you came from the channel here.